Our next speaker comes to us from across the pond, Augustin Trinquart, in Paris, in France, from Auslandia.
Hi.
Hi. How's it going?
Fine. Thank you very much.
I've been asking everybody to get the chance, and I got a couple minutes here. So what was your first exposure to Postgis? How did you end up becoming a Postgis user?
By becoming an employee at Auslandia. Mm. So before that, I never even heard about Postgis. So, and so since 2016, basically.
All right. Well, yeah, joining Auslandia will definitely dump you in the deep end with Postgis. So great. I'm looking forward to your talk. If you could share your slides so we can all see them.
Yep.
And we'll be hearing now from Augustin Trinquart, building a Postgis web application with PG TileServe and PG FeatureServe. Take it away, Augustin.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Can do.
Perfect. So indeed, hi everyone. I'm going to talk about PG FeatureServe, PG TileServe, and a bit of general presentation, what they allowed you to do, what I think are the most interesting feature, and how we have used it at Auslandia. So, okay. So Auslandia is a service company. So we build application, JS application for our customers. And basically, in the past, we had no real choices. So we serve map as raster to client, to front-end, web front-end. And so it involves having a rendering engine on the server. So for example, a QGIS server, a map server, or a Geo server. And this application, we're doing all the heavy lifting of transforming vector data into raster to serve into to front. And in front, we use, of course, OpenLayers or Leaflet or other framework to display these images. So eventually, to complete the stack, we can have a backend, applicative backend. And for example, at Auslandia, we often use Python and Flask. And so now, since some time ago, yeah, we can see that habits are shifting towards vector tiles. Which means also client-side rendering. So just a quick word, because I find it interesting, of what are the advantages of client-side rendering, according to me. So, for example, you can have some dynamic styling directly on the client. You don't have to download again some images to change the style. So it allows you to do animation on hover, for example, or on click. Also, it's easier to pick a feature under the mouse, for example. And because you can embed some metadata in the tile, in the vector tile, you don't need necessarily to do some get feature info queries to get basic information about your feature, for example. And so it makes it means that you don't need this this rendering engine, and so it could potentially make your stack lighter. And yeah, you saw basically you're offloading the rendering load, in my opinion, where it makes most sense, meaning in the front, because actually the front has more information about the, for example, the viewport size or the font size than the server, of course. And something that I haven't yet seen in the wild, but I really would really much like to see it, is accessibility feature for web mapping. So I haven't seen that, maybe it already exists, but yeah, so we can imagine, for example, having a high contrast map or changing the size of the labels according to some accessibility settings. So if we don't need a rendering engine, the question is, do we still need a QGIS server or a GIS server or a map server? Well, it turns out that they still do a bit more than just a rendering raster. So they connect to data sources, they present an HTTP server, and they also deal with OGC protocol compatibility. So that's actually what we can keep we can keep from these servers. So that's the idea under PG TileServe and PG FeatureServe. And when you think about it, Postgis can already output vector data like GeoJSON and MVT. Front clients, they all know how to read it. So in the middle, it shouldn't be that complex. And so we keep these three elements, connection to PostGIS, standard protocol support, and some bonuses that I will talk a bit later. So the idea actually is not really, it's not new, because before that we were doing it with homemade API in Python and Flask. And at Ossandia, we already experimented with a server similar to PGTileServe in the past. It was called PostTile. But until now, I think we were missing a nice, well-designed solution that would be production-ready and that we can use for our customers. And I think PGTileServe and PGFeatureServe really fill that need. So let's take a bit about the common points between these two servers. They are written in Go, developed by Crunchy Data. So they present a REST API. They connect to PostGIS only. So a choice has been made here to support only one data source. And it allows us to also to really leverage PostGIS at the maximum. And to get going, you just need to configure the DB connection, basically. And here you go. You can save tables, views, and also functions. And actually, this is for me the fact you can serve functions, you can call functions to webroot, is for me a really interesting feature and one of the most important of this service. So PGTileServe, to speak a bit about the particular point of PGTileServe, so it supports the XYZ tile system protocol, so pretty standard and simple protocol, and it serves Mapbox vector tile data. And so here's an example of the URL you would use for a table in a database. So it's pretty standard XYZ URL. So for PGTileServe, the granularity is a tile. So it serves tile and tile only. On the other hand, PGFeatureServe implement a part of the ODC API features protocol. And the format of the data is a GeoJSON if you have some geometry data in the result set, or JSON otherwise. So I won't do a complete presentation of the OGC Features API, but here are some examples of how you can query your data set. So you can filter by B-boxes, by property values, and also do some ordering, limit the number of results, limit what properties are returned, do some paging, et cetera, et cetera. And so for PGFeatureServe, the granularity, it's not the tile, so it really returns a set of features that that you have queried according to the criteria. So there's no, actually, you don't have any geographic coherence as for PGTileServe, so it's really a set of features. Both projects include metadata, both in human readable format and JSON formats. And we have a preview for the data, which is really nice. So for example, this is the home page of PGTileServe. If you start it and you go to the home, you have this page. So we have links to JSON metadata for the whole service that you can consume in your application, for example. And you have as well the list of layer in your database. So here we can see I don't have any table layers, but I do have some function layers. So I can preview the function. I can also have a description in JSON. And here you have the comment that you have attached in the database to the function. So it's really nice. It means that you can comment your database schema as you do, maybe as you do, and then the comment will be here. And it's a nice way, in my opinion, to document your API. So PGFeatureServe present a similar homepage, and you also have this Swagger UI, which is embedded in the PGTileServe web pages. So PGFeatureServe, sorry, web pages. So for those who don't know Swagger, so it gives you a list of routes available to your service, and you can click on the routes, and you have a more thorough description with parameters, and also you can test. You can live test your routes directly on the server through this UI. Okay, so that's a preview of one data set. Okay, so that's a preview of PG Feature Serve, but PG Tile Serve has a similar preview. So you can see your data set, and here I have clicked on one of the cities, actually the TC city limits, and I can see the metadata table of the metadata of this particular feature. So all this preview and the metadata, these are, in my opinion, little details that that really matters when you want to use a solution, and it really makes this service really easy to use and a pleasure. And it saves a lot of time and energy just to be able to debug easily, to see if your connection is set up correctly, and also to be able to consume metadata about your service in your application. So that's one of the, for me, of the key points that make the servers production ready. So it's really nice. Okay, so let's talk about functions. So for me, that's the most interesting feature of these two servers. And actually, it makes them able to do things that you cannot do with QGIS server and Geo server. And I'll try to show an example later. You can do these things with map server because you can actually have some query template. But with QGIS, for example, if you want there are some views that won't allow you to do some geographic filter before reading the data set. And so that makes some views impractical to use in QGIS, for example. And you can use them through functions in a PG Tile Serve and PG Feature Serve. So let's give an example. Maybe it's easier to grasp how it looks like. So this is a function for PG Tile Serve. So PG Tile Serve will pick up any function that has these parameters, ZXY, which has the coordinate are the coordinates of the tile, basically. And that returns by TR. And basically, the best way to do it is to use the ST as MVT project function. So here, this simple example is just a debug example that I often use if I want to benchmark how a client application behave, how they switch to one Z to the other. And basically, I calculate the envelope of the tile, and I create a tile with it, embedding as well ZXY as metadata. And actually, I think it's really interesting because this is not there is no table or real data behind that. It's just all generated data, so it can give you a glimpse of what's possible with these functions. You can really do what you want. So here's a screenshot of this function in action. So yeah, basically it draws tiles, and if you identify this is in QGIS. If you identify a particular tile, you have the metadata you have embedded in the tile. Here's another more complex example for PG Feature Serve. So PG Feature Serve will pick up basically any function that returns a set of record or table. And so for example, this little function, but the function need to be in the PostGIS for the web schema, so PostGIS FTW schema. And it makes sense because otherwise PG Feature Serve will just pick up any function in the database, maybe too many functions. So here, this little function just from a data set, which are the buildings in Paris, actually, in this precise example, it takes all the buildings in a circle defined by this longitude and latitude and the radius, and cut them according to this circle and gives back the feature. So actually, I won't show the code in detail, but we just filter with std within here, and we intersect the geometry there. And we also embed in the tile the ID, the numero and contenance, which are the metadata of the tile set. And because the std within can use the geometry index, this is very fast. Okay, so in action, it looks like this. So this is, I don't expect this to be, this kind of example to be usable in production, but it gives a little showcase of what's possible with PG Feature Serve. Okay, so here are another couple of function ideas. that you can use in your application. So for example, you can imagine using PostgreSQL full text search features on some properties. So we actually already done that for one of our projects. So it allows you to have fine features with a search box really easily. You can do all sorts of geometry manipulation, like display centers instead of geometry, or I don't know, inscribed circles, though I don't know how it would be useful. Or for example, aggregate buildings according to city blocks or stuff like that, I don't know. Also, other idea with log table or versioning, you could implement an history browser to get a state of a particular dataset at a particular time. And also one other example I have used in production is to display really big dataset with PG TileServe and to switch to a cache for low Z values for that. So I'm gonna present this use case later. So yeah, so we have all the power actually of the languages that PostgreSQL supports. So the only limit is our imagination, basically. Okay, so let's talk a bit about this use case. So to give you a bit of context, this was one of our customer in France. They have a lot of depth measurement on the sea floors. And so the dataset is quite big. It's already more than 2 billion points and more are planned. And they want to query the dataset. And they also want to visualize the points in the map application. So we have stored the point with a PostgreSQL extension that is called Keep on Cloud. And this extension very quickly allows you to group the points in a geographically coherent partition. And and we call this partition patches. So as the dataset is already big, we cannot really plug PGTileServe directly to the table because, of course, if you want to query the tile of z equal to zero, for example, it will mean that you will have to query the whole table, and it's really not feasible. So we implemented a cache in another table, and so the format of the table is this one. It's really simple actually. So we cache each tile of low z values. So we store z, x, y to keep the coordinate of the tile, and we create a patch containing a subset of the points of this geographic area. And basically, we aim at keeping enough points to have a good visual results while keeping good performances. So we have a trade-off to find here. And also we have to be careful how we decimate the points just to keep the relative density of each zone. So I won't show all the functions, but you can recognize the signature that PGTileServe will support. And then it's actually a simple example, simple heuristic. So if Z is greater than 17, we just query the real table, the referential data set. Otherwise, we just query our cache. And as we filter by Z, X, Y, so the three integers that are indexed, the selection is really fast. Actually, the most time is spent reading the disk and transforming the dataset from patches to MVT. So yeah, so this consideration of cache are hidden from the web stack. So we don't need any, for example, any map proxy. And I personally like it. I prefer when my cache is near my data. So for me, it makes quite sense to maintain, if my data is in the database, maintain the cache in the database so that it's easier for me to manage. So here is a little GIF of what's going on. So the first few levels are quite fast to query because we are querying the cache. And then the more we zoom at the last level, we are actually querying the real table. And here the color represents the depth of the depth measurement. Okay, so to conclude, let's summarize a bit the pros and the limitation of this solution. So I really like the simplicity of it and the stability. So there's nearly nothing between my database and the web client. And as most of our logic usually, well, often it's on the database and we use PostGIS a lot, it makes sense for us to use these servers. The quality is good, so I've spoken about all the little niceties we can have. It allows us to have a lot of flexibility with functions. And actually, it makes deploying new endpoints really easy. So just deploying an endpoint, you create an object, you grant a permission to the user, PGTile Server and PGFeatureServe are using to connect to the database, and then you have deployed your new endpoint. In contrast, if you have a Java or Python application, you usually need to deploy new code and then restart the server. Here, you don't have to do this. You can just leverage the PostgreSQL capabilities in this area, which allows you to hot swap code how you want. So yeah, if you want to change code, you just have to change a function definition. You can do it in a transaction and you can do it live in prod. For give you the, yeah, to remind a bit of the scope of the project. So limitations for me is not, I don't mean it in a negative way. It's more that limitation come with choice. And simply this is not the focus of the project to deal with authentication, for example. So you can emulate authentication with having several services with several PostgreSQL users, but it won't scale with a lot of users. And of course, you might still need a backend server for stuff that are more like what we want to do in web, support workflows, sending mails, having basically side effects other than presenting data. And you might still need the raster layers, for example, if you have some orthophoto or stuff like that. So, and that won't be supported by these servers. So because I know that some crunchy data people and Paul are listening to me, maybe I can give a bit of wish list for PGTileServe and PGFeatureServe. So somehow I'd like to have a support for a set role before PostgreSQL queries. So I don't know how it can look, but that would be really nice to specify, hey, I want the rights of this user to apply for this query. And also actually some customer requested the customization of the PostGIS for the win for the web schema name because they have a nomenclature. So, but I'm sure that it's simple to do actually. So thank you very much for your attention. So yeah, these are two really nice pieces of software in my opinion that we already use in production. And I'm sure you can too today.
Wow, thank you very much, Augustine, for walking us through those two pieces of software. They were very fun to write, and it's been exciting to see people putting them to use in the real world. I had a quick question for you, which is how you're deploying it in production. Where do you run it? I was very pleased to see Tom Van Tilburg's presentation and that he was deploying into Kubernetes, because that was kind of the remit that we were operating under as we started writing it, was to make something that was small and easy to deploy into a microservices context, which kind of meant containers. So how are you guys doing that?
I'm a kind of an old fashioned guy, so I used to do just systemd services and then I'm good to go. Yeah. So actually I've never deployed it for customers because the customers we implemented the function for them, actually they deploy themselves in the application. But I think they might use Docker, for example. And but the nice thing is that you can actually deploy however you want, because it's a simple executable, so you don't have any limitation in that. So.
Yeah, it almost seems like overkill to have a whole container just to hold this one little fat executable. Do you have a question from Tom? Tom Van Tilburg asks about the example that does an ST intersects in PGFeatureServe function. We had the impression that a vanilla SQL function doesn't trigger the use of indexes. Did you test that?
Why would a vanilla SQL function won't trigger the use of indexes? There's
yeah,
no,
so
no, that.
come back with that to Tom, which is there's no reason that SQL functions shouldn't trigger indexes. They're stuffed into the planner just like everything else is. They do end up going through a slightly different plan path than PLPGSQL. So if you've got something which is maybe on the edge of using an index or not, it may or may not trigger well. But not having the indexes come into play if you have them, this is kind of a bad sign and maybe worthy of a bit of diagnosis to figure out what's going on. It is worth pointing out though that there is definitely a lower overhead on PLPGSQL functions. So if particularly when you get down to like the really small tiles that load really, really fast, the actual overhead of running the function can start to be a non-trivial portion of the overall query time. So PLPGSQL actually has an advantage there because they turn over a little faster. They get pre-compiled and cached, whereas
but
the SQL functions have to reparse every time.
The inside the function, every query will use the indexes if there is one actually. So
yeah. Cool. I think that's it. Do we have any more questions here?
And so, yeah, Tom, I did test that, and in the example, the index is used.
Okay. Thank you again very much, Augustin. Would you hang around in the chat in the Q&A for folks who have late coming questions? I'll put your claps in the chat.